Well, good morning, everyone. My name is Bryan, and I'm the best-looking Bradshaw that we have. No, it's so fun to be back in Crystal Lake with so many friends and family that I love. Last week, I think I was called Greg about 4 or 5 times out in the lobby, so it's good to be back. Don't worry, I'm not offended. My senior football coach in college called me Greg my entire senior year, so I'm for sure used to it. But I'm really, really excited to be back in Crystal Lake, excited to be opening God's Word with you this morning. And it's a really special day for me. I remember 3 years ago, I was teaching at Dundee Crown High School, and felt like God was calling me into ministry, and I was standing right back there in the back of an empty worship center, just looking at all the chairs and looking at the stage and just dreaming about the day or the chance, Lord willing, that I would have to open God's Word and bring it to His people. And today is that day, and so thank you. As I just look around and I see a lot of old faces and people I've known for a long time, I started to come to this church when I think I was 9 years old. And watching the way that many of you lived your life and the way that you loved Jesus had a big impact on me. And even greater than that was watching my parents and the way that they love God's Word and showing me what it means to love God's Word. It's not too often that people get to come back to a place like that and then get to preach. And so I am super blessed, really excited. Would be lying if I said I wasn't a little bit nervous. It's very similar to the feeling that I would get when I was still playing football, that excitement and nervousness that usually would go away when I would get that first really big hit in the game. So, Marty, stay in your seat. I don't need that to happen right now. So, this morning we're going to be talking about refreshment, and I was thinking of things this week in people's lives that they may experience that brings refreshment to them. And so I think about a really hot day, you know, cannonballing into a pool or a lake and just feeling the water come over you, or the fact that the Bears are actually good again. The Packers are still better, I'm just saying. a day off with nothing on your calendar, or that first warm day after a long winter. These are things that we can relate to that bring refreshing. And this morning we're going to look at a passage from God's Word that may be familiar to some of you, that captures this idea of having our soul refreshed. And so we're going to be in John 4. This morning, looking at the woman at the well. So if you have your Bible, please open up to John 4. We titled the message, Refreshed by Living Water. And so we're going to look at what God has for us. I'm going to pray real quick, and then we're going to dive in. God, thank you for the amazing opportunity we had to worship you already this morning. Thank you for giving us your word. I pray that you would speak your words this morning through me, that we would leave impacted by the words that you've given us. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. So before we jump in, I just want to give you a little context of what's going on where we pick up in John 4. So Jesus is at the beginning of his earthly ministry, and he's gaining popularity as people are starting to hear about him, and he's teaching and he's healing, but also at the same time he's starting to gain this opposition against him. And so he and his disciples have been hanging out in Judea, are now going to travel back to Galilee. So they're going to head north, and right in between is Samaria. It's a region. It's not necessarily a town, but it's a region, and they are going to travel through Samaria. Now, In this time, a lot of Jewish people, when they needed to travel back and forth, would just completely go around Samaria. They didn't want anything to do with the people or the land. And we'll get into that in a little bit of why. But they would just go around. But here we see Jesus traveling right through the middle. And he's probably at this point been traveling for quite a few hours. And so he is hot and thirsty and weary. Even though he was fully God, he also was fully man. And so he feels the same things that many of us feel. And so this is where we pick up the story here in verse 7. A woman from Samaria came to draw water. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink," for his disciples had gone away into the city to buy food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask for a drink from me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him and he would have given you living water." The woman said to him, "Sir, you have nothing to draw water with, and the well is deep. Where do you get that living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob? He gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did his sons and his livestock." Jesus said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never be thirsty again. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life." So our first point this morning is, my source of refreshment is Jesus. My source of refreshment is Jesus. And so we see here in verse 7, the woman shows up to the well. Jesus is there alone. His disciples have gone into the city to buy food. And Jesus begins this conversation with the woman. And it's important to know here that in the end of verse 6, it says it was about the sixth hour. So this is about noon. And in this time, women would normally go and get water every day. Water is a necessity of life, and so they would go out to the well, usually in the morning when it was cooler, to draw water. And they would kind of make it a social thing. You know, like the girls are getting together for coffee or going shopping. They were going to the well and get water. And so they would go together. But here we see a woman coming at noon and she's by herself. And so we're going to see as we get into this probably why that's happened. But this woman is most likely suggested to be considered an outcast of this town. And so it's about noon. We see Jesus interacting with her at a well. So I think of a local gas station for us, a very common place. Everyone has to go to it at some point. And you wouldn't expect to run into a rabbi or a teacher at the local well. That's just not a place that you would find someone like this. But here we see the Savior of the world, Jesus Christ, sitting there alone, waiting while his disciples go and get food for this woman. I just love this about Jesus. He's not waiting for the perfect place, or it doesn't have to be a special place to meet with you. Our God will meet with us wherever we are. And then finally, this relationship between Jews and Samaritans. And so I want to make sure we understand it. And I've been thinking, how can I explain how they feel about each other? And I thought about the movie Miracle. How many of you have seen the movie Miracle? Okay, some people. For those of you who haven't watched it, this might make a little bit more sense. But this relationship between Jews and Samaritans are like hockey players from Minnesota and Boston. They do not like each other at all. And the reason for that is because during the Old Testament, when the Jews were exiled, there were some that stayed in the land and foreigners came in. And these Jews that stayed ended up intermarrying some of these foreigners. And so pure Jews looked at these people as unclean or impure. And so they didn't really like them at all. And so here we see Jesus passing through Samaria, engaging in a conversation with a Samaritan woman. And this, right, like that in itself is amazing. Because in Jesus' time, men would go out into public and they just wouldn't speak to women. Even if they went with their wife, they wouldn't. They wouldn't talk to them while they were in public. And here Jesus is breaking down many, many barriers that potentially could stand in the way from this woman having an encounter and an experience with Jesus Christ. And so, I just love this about who Jesus is. It doesn't matter how old you are, what race you are, what your ethnicity, what your gender is, what you've done in your past, none of that matters. None of that matters. Jesus sees everyone with dignity and value. And he loves you and he welcomes you. And I don't know if you're here, maybe some of you are here today and you have felt that from other people at some point. And that's not the type of God that we have. That's not the type of God that we have. Nothing stopped Jesus from going to this woman. Nothing stops Jesus from going to you. And so for us, that should mean nothing should stop us from going to others. Nothing. It shouldn't matter what political party they're a part of, or what socioeconomic class they are, or what high school they go to, or how old they are. None of that should matter. We see Jesus tearing these barriers down to go and have this conversation of who he really is with this woman. We need to be doing the same to the people in our life. It doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. We need to see everyone with dignity and value like Jesus does. But now you can understand here why the woman's response was what it was. She's like, why are you speaking to me? You Jews don't deal with us. And he explains in verse 10 a little bit. Let's look at that. If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, give me a drink, you would have asked him and he would have given you living water. So he's saying, if only you knew who asked you to give you a drink, you, not me, you would be asking me to give you a drink. And Jesus says he would have given you living water. And so we know, we have the entire New Testament, we have the Bible, we know what this living water is, this living water of the life that we have found in Jesus Christ. He brings us salvation and eternal life. And that's what he's talking about. He offers that to you and to me. We all have it. And so the woman is just, she's confused. She's still confused. You can give me this living water. She's like, you don't have anything to get it from the well. Where is this water coming from? And she's trying to understand who this guy is at this moment. Are you greater than Jacob? Like, he came here and he drank from this well. Do I drink from this well? And Jesus says, everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks of the water I give him will never be thirsty again. See, Jesus knew that this woman needed water every day to satisfy her natural thirst. Not just this woman, but everyone. Even us. We need water. So he uses thirst as a picture of the spiritual need and longing that she had. He uses thirst as a picture of the spiritual need and longing the woman had, and we're no different. We need water. And so recently I was gifted this water bottle. It's a hydro flask. My girlfriend Abby bought it for me, I think because she was tired of me just drinking all of her water when she would have hers. And so I now have this water bottle. I've had it for like 2 weeks, and I don't think I've had to go to the bathroom as many times as I've had in the last 2 weeks since I've had this, but wherever I go, I have it. I leave the house, I have my water bottle. I leave my office, I take my water bottle with me. I always have it, and I'm always taking drinks of it when I'm thirsty because I'm able to get refreshed. And this is what Jesus is saying to us. In the same way that physical water refreshes you, I will refresh you spiritually. I, Jesus, himself, the person of who he is, I am your source. I am your source. So what does this mean for us? You know, I think it depends on where you are at when you come here this morning. Maybe you are here and you've heard about Jesus. It's just kind of this thing you know about. And you've never actually had a drink of the living water that Jesus is offering you. And your life is always filled with this thirst for something more. It reminds me, I'll never forget this, after Tom Brady had won a couple Super Bowls, he's married to a supermodel, he has more money than he knows what to do with, he said there has to be more. There has to be more than this. I've reached the top in every category the world would say to reach to. And he's like, there's got to be more. And so maybe some of you are here and you're like, there's got to be something more. I would say this morning maybe is the first time that you drink from this living water that God is offering you. And you can be refreshed by it. And maybe some of you have drank this living water and you've accepted the gift of eternal life, but you come in here and you're just running dry. You feel empty. You've been running on your own strength maybe for too long, or you're just really tired. You've been weary from all the things that you're doing. I would just remind you that Jesus is saying, drink again from the source. Drink from me. Let me refresh you. And so here are four ways to be refreshed by Jesus that I think might help you. Number one is make a list of God's goodness. This is something I did at the end of this past month. And I just started thinking about, what are all the ways God has been good to me this month? I just wrote them down. He brought my brother back home safely from serving in Afghanistan. I'd see him answered specific prayer requests that I'd been praying. He provided a new opportunity for me in Crystal Lake. He protected me when I got into my car accident. Thing after thing after thing after thing. I'm just writing down ways God has been good to me. And it refreshes me. I can see God working in my life and the way that he's there for me. And so maybe this week, maybe in your small group, you take 10 minutes and you go around and each person gets to say, hey, this is one way in the past week or past month that God has been good to me. It reminds us of his goodness. Number two, second way to be refreshed by Jesus, go back to the cross. Just go back to the cross. Go back to the beginning. Remind yourself what Jesus has saved you from. He saved you, he saved me from our sin. We were lost, we were blind, we didn't have a way, we didn't have a hope. But because of the cross, we do now. We have this life. And so go through Scripture and just remind yourself of that truth. So I jotted down a couple. Maybe you can jot them down. I apologize, they're not on the screen, so just jot them down real quick. Spend some time this week. Go back to these passages. Ephesians chapter 1 and chapter 2. Colossians chapter 2, verse 13 and 14. Romans chapter 5, 6 through 8. Reignite that passion that you had that first time you became a new creation in Christ. That will bring refreshment to you. Number three, find some solitude. So solitude, the definition is the absence of human interaction to make room for supernatural interaction. And so what does this mean? Well, this means that you find a place in your life and you get away from your email. You get away from your texts, you get away from your computer, you get away from people, and you just sit and enjoy the presence of God. And just to encourage you, this week as I was prepping for this morning, I made this kind of a routine in my day. I would just take a break, I would go sit for 20 minutes, 15, 20 minutes, and I would feel so refreshed after. Just God ministering to me and just enjoying His Word and His presence being with me. It was really life-giving. And then lastly, four ways to be refreshed by Jesus: invest in life-giving relationships. So spend some time with people in your life who you know give you some life. And not necessarily just because it's always fun, but because they're going to encourage you with God's Word, they're going to pray with you. And there's a couple people like that in my life. One of them is Brandon DeLage. And if you know Brandon, you know that his laugh alone is refreshing when you hear it. But he's the type of person that just when I'm around, it breathes freshness into me because he spurs me on in the Lord. And so those four things are things that you can do to be refreshed by Jesus. And so we see the woman say, "Sir, give me this water." She's like, "I'm in. This sounds great. Give me this water. If I don't have to come back to the well, if I don't have to work as hard every day and come get it, then I'm in. Count me in." And that's not exactly what Jesus is saying here. He's not offering you an easier life. The thing that he's offering you is a better life. It's a satisfied life. And it's a refreshed life. And it comes from the source of himself. Okay, and so she's just not quite there yet. The woman, she's like, "I want it so I don't have to come here." And so our next point helps us understand why she responds this way. And it's my awareness of sin is the start. We're going to keep reading in verse 16. Jesus said to her, "Go, call your husband and come here." The woman answered him, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying, 'I have no husband,' for you've had five husbands, and the one you now have is not your husband. What you have said is true." The woman said to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." So she hasn't yet received this truth or this gift of living water that Jesus is offering. And so Jesus is now making her aware of her sin. He says, "If you want the water, great. Go get your husband and bring him back here." And she's like, I can't. And Jesus is like, "You're right. You can't, because you've had five and you're now with someone who's not your husband." And in one sentence, Jesus shows her that he knows everything about her life. It's not a secret anymore. It would almost be as if your last week, everything that you said, all your interactions, what you did, was put up on the projector for us to see. This is what's happening here. Out of nowhere, Jesus knows this woman's past, just like he knows ours. And so before she can be refreshed, she needs to deal with her sin. And this was her first step towards Jesus. And we see him confronting her of this and making her aware of this by bringing it up. And he does this for us too. He does this for us too. The woman's unsatisfying substitute, we talked about the source of refreshment being Jesus. Her substitute for refreshment had been in her husband's or in other people. And so it makes me think about, I don't know, 3 weeks ago, my family went out to New York to welcome my brother home. And we stayed at this fun farmhouse. And I have a picture of the barn that was connected just kind of off to the side of the farmhouse. So this is on the property. And in the top floor, it had like a basketball hoop and a volleyball net. And it had this room. It was broken off into two. And on one side, it was just this empty room. And we're at a farmhouse. And that was a new experience for us. We haven't spent a lot of time on the farm, so we were looking for things to do. And we ended up playing a lot of soccer. And soccer is not my go-to sport. I'm just going to be honest. I've never played. I kind of was always teased in the past about it from people. But we ended up having a ton of fun. And afterwards, I was exhausted. I mean, this barn, it was hot. It was muggy up there. It was hard to breathe. And so I was tired. I came back down. I went to the house. My leg hurt in places that I didn't know could, because in 28 years, I had never done this motion. And I had done that motion for like 3 hours in a row, and my leg was really hurting, and I was extremely thirsty. And so I came in, and I went to the fridge, and there are a couple things that I saw in the fridge. The first was some milk. Now, I'm a milk guy. I love milk. And I'm not talking skim milk. I think that tastes like water. I'm talking the whole milk. I guess you're supposed to kind of drink this when you're a baby and then kind of wean off it, but I just stuck with it. So I don't know if I'm to blame my dad or my mom for that, but this is what I drink. And it's really refreshing. It could be a nice, tall, cold glass of milk. But I bypassed it, and there was a Coke in there. And so I looked at that. There's just something about popping open a can of Coke, where I almost feel like I'm refreshed before I even took a sip, just by hearing the noise of it. But you could choose to have Coke, and it could be a little bit refreshing and satisfy you maybe in the moment. But you're going to have all that carbonation sitting in your stomach, and it's probably not going to be the best for you. So I thought, okay, maybe a better option. A Gatorade. Okay, now I'm speaking my dad's language here, all right? Gatorade. That's the way we were raised. Drink Gatorade. It's better than water. It's better than anything. Their slogan is thirst quencher. You're thirsty? Drink a Gatorade. And so, again, it's an option, but it's not the best option. So I still have yet to have a drink. I've looked at all my options. What do you think I chose to have? A cold glass of refreshing water. Water. Take a sip. You just feel it go throughout your entire body, cool you down, and you're like, okay. That's what I needed. So what's the point? The point is that sometimes we try to refresh and satisfy ourselves with things other than Jesus. We think that it might satisfy us, and maybe it does for a short period of time. But ultimately, we're still going to be left thirsty. And so when we try and satisfy or refresh our soul with anything other than Jesus, that is sin. That is sin. It's the sin of idolatry. So here are four unsatisfying substitutes that sometimes we go to. The first one is things. We go to things. It's always got to be bigger and better. We got to upgrade our car model to the 2020. We need a little bit better house. Once I get that promotion, then I'll be fully satisfied. I'll have the big paycheck coming in. I'll have everything that I need. I got to get the new phone. I got to get Madden 20. I got to get that brand of clothes. So when I go to school, everyone sees me and they say, wow, he really has the high-end stuff. These things, we look for that to satisfy us. Secondly, sometimes we look to hobbies. Playing sports, or watching that show on Netflix, or working out, reading. Now, these things in themselves aren't bad. These are not bad things. But when you can't miss that episode, or you can't miss that practice, or that game, or that workout, but you can miss spending time with the Lord, with Jesus Christ, and being filled with the refreshment that He gives you. It's sin. Maybe your unsatisfying substitute is a substance. It's alcohol, or it's drugs, or it's sex, or it's something that satisfies your body that you turn to fill that hurt or the loneliness. Or maybe it's people. Your value is coming from others, your worth, the affirmation that you get. Did you get enough likes on your Instagram page or on your Facebook post? Do your teammates love you? If those are the things that you're getting your satisfaction from and not Jesus, that's sin. And so before the woman, before we're able to receive this refreshment from the living water, we need to see and be aware of our sin. And so if there's a sin that you're aware of maybe this morning that you need to confess, I just say confess it. Confess it today. Don't try to run around it. Step around it. Just repent and turn to Jesus. He's the refreshment for your soul. And so we need to be aware of our sin before we're refreshed. That's the start. So my source of refreshment is Jesus. My awareness of sin is the start. Our third point, my worship of God is the response. Verse 20. Our fathers worshipped on this mountain, but you say that in Jerusalem is the place where people ought to worship. Jesus said to her, "Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know, for salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming and is now here when the true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For the Father is seeking such people to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship in spirit and truth." The woman said to him, "I know the Messiah is coming, he who is called Christ. When he comes, he will tell us all things." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." And so we could spend a whole another message talking about this. My worship of God is the response. But Jesus is patient with the woman. And so he's revealed the source. He's made her aware of her sin. And so now he goes into a answering her question about worship. And he's making it clear that it's not about the place. Worship is not about the place. You see, the Samaritans would go up onto this mountain and worship. And the Jews would go to Jerusalem to the temple and worship. And that's what she's saying here. Well, where is it? Where's the place? Jesus is saying, it's not about a place. It's about the who. It's about me. And it's about the heart and your mind that you bring when you're worshiping. And so I just got back from Camp Harvest. I was up there with our high school students from Elgin and Crystal Lake, and we had an awesome week. Ben did an amazing job leading our students. And we had a conversation while we were up there, the guys in my cabin, about why they think or thought that God always meets with them in such a special way up at camp. We started to talk about some different things, and they realized, and I was able to share with them, that it's not because it's in northern Michigan, it's not because it's in the basement of the lodge up at camp, that they feel refreshed and met with, that they met with God. It's because they go up there anticipating what God's going to do. They're ready. They're already leaning in their worship. You see the passion come out. They're fired up. They're expecting God to say something to them when they go there. And they create room and space for God to move in their hearts while they're there. And so I was just trying to help them see it's the same here as it is there. You can encounter and experience God in the same way as you do at camp. You just have to choose to worship and create that space for God to meet with you that you do when you go up to the camp. And it's the same for us. It could be Act Like Men Palooza. It could be in your small group. It could be in a Bible study you're doing, or just meeting one-on-one with a mentor, coming to church on Sunday morning. It's about where your heart is. And God, Jesus is bringing that out even more when he describes a true worshiper. In verse 23, true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. In spirit and truth. The key word here is and. Spirit and truth. See, this idea of spirit and truth, it's not about 50% spirit, 50% truth, then I am full. They're not competing against each other. It's 100% of spirit and 100% of truth. One is fueling the other. Your worship in spirit is fueling your worship in truth, and vice versa. You can't have worship to God without one. It'd be incomplete. We need to have both. It was so awesome just standing here, listening, watching us worship the Lord this morning in spirit, raising our hands, lifting our voices, and in truth, singing truth about who we know God to be, what he says he is in his word. You see, worship is, it's our response to the revelation of who God is. And it's when we ascribe worth to him. I'm so thankful for Pastor Eddie and how he's taught us that this summer. Ascribing worth to Jesus Christ. And so as we grow as believers in Christ, the longer we're following him, the more we will worship in spirit and in truth. How can it not be this way? How can that not be our response to Jesus Christ? I love that we're having a worship night on Thursday. Another chance to not hold back and to give God everything he deserves and is worthy of. And so truth and spirit, they go hand in hand. God wants, he wants it all. He wants it all. I was just thinking about when I was a little kid, I would sit here in the front row next to my parents, and I was always a little bit hesitant to raise my hand in worship. Well, what are my parents going to think? Am I going to have to talk to them about it afterwards? Is my mom going to ask me 10 questions about why I was doing it? What are the people behind me are going to think? I'm sitting in the front row. I'm being, you know, everyone's going to see me. When we worship in spirit and truth, we don't hold back. We just give it all to God because he's worthy of it all. And that's what he wants us to be. He wants us to be true worshipers. And here's the thing. He's looking. He's looking for this type, this kind of worshiper. Is he finding you? Are you growing in your worship of spirit and truth? And so, when he gets done talking about worship, the woman responds, I know the Messiah is coming, and he's going to talk about these things. And Jesus says, I who speak to you am he. I'm he. I'm just picturing this woman, her face, when he says this. I just had this conversation with this guy. He said he can offer me living water. He's told me all the things that I've ever done. No wonder. I'm talking to the Messiah, the Christ. And in an instant, the light bulb goes on. And her eyes are open, and we see the result of what happens here in our last point. My witness for God is the result. My witness for God is the result. Let's look at verse 27. Just then his disciples came back. They marveled that he was talking with a woman. But no one said, what do you seek? Or why are you talking with her? I think at this point the disciples realize Like, Jesus knows what he's doing and has a reason for doing it. Verse 28, so the woman left her water jar and went away into town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. Can this be the Christ? They went out of the town and were coming to him. Encounters with Jesus change everything. Encounters with Jesus change everything, and we see that in this woman's life. And because of her encounter, we see Jesus give her four things that he gives us. Number one, a boldness. A boldness. Remember, this woman came to the well alone. She came alone. I'm sure she felt some shame and guilt, unwanted. But now, what does she do? She leaves her water jar. It's not about the water anymore. She has this encounter, so she is heading straight to town to tell the people. She can't deny what just happened to her. She has to go. And it's because of the result of her meeting with Jesus and him revealing himself to her. So he gives her a boldness. She went away into town. Second thing he gives you, a story. He gives you a story. What does she do? She says, come see a man who told me all that I ever did. She just tells her story. I guarantee you the people in the town knew who this woman was. They knew she had had five husbands. They knew that she wasn't living with her husband now. And here she is, back. Come see. He told me everything. What God does in your life is a story worth telling, so tell it. Sometimes the fear of what are we supposed to say, or I don't think I can articulate it right, get in the way and they hold us up. Just tell people what he's done in your life. That's it. He's always doing something. So just tell people. He gives us a boldness, a story, a role. He gives us a role. Many Samaritans from that town believed in him because of the woman's testimony. He told me all that I ever did. So when the Samaritans came to him, they asked him to stay, and he stayed 2 days. And many more believed because of his word. And they said to the woman, it is no longer because of what you have said that we believe, for we have heard for ourselves, and we know that this is indeed the Savior of the world. So she goes. She tells her story. And some people, because of her testimony, respond to Jesus Christ. And she reaps. And some people respond and just go and see. Who is this man? And because of his word, they believe. So she was sowing. She was planting the seed. And it doesn't matter if you've been a Christian for 1 hour or 50 years. We all have a role to play. You see, because there are people in your life that you can reach that I can't. And there are people in my life that I can reach that you can't. And we have a role. And lastly, Jesus gives us a joy. He gives us a joy. In verse 36, it says, already the one who reaps is receiving wages and gathering fruit for eternal life, so that sower and reaper may rejoice together. You see, when we see God move, in people's lives, whether it's a result of something we did or because of the prayers we've been praying for years and years and years. When God moves, regardless of what your role is, we get to rejoice. It's like when we watch a baptism. Every time, it never gets old. And there's joy because you're seeing another life changed. And so we get to be a part of it all. And we get to have joy. And we rejoice in the things that God is doing. So don't stop doing the work of God. Keep serving. Keep praying. Keep loving. Keep telling people about Jesus Christ. Don't quit. Our witness for God is the result of being refreshed by Him. Why don't you bow your heads with me? In a moment, I'm going to pray. And I wonder if there are people here today that are needing to be refreshed by Jesus Christ for the first time. You're thirsty. You're searching for something. And the answer is Jesus. And maybe you are aware of a sin pattern in your life, and that's the start for you to confess that to the Lord. The beginning of your refreshment is to confess that. Maybe you're just tired and weary, and you haven't seen God move in a while. You've been sowing and sowing and sowing, and you just need refreshment. Or maybe you just need a fresh encounter with the living God. If any of those people are you this morning, I'd love if you would just raise your hand. I just want to pray for you. I'm not going to ask you to come up. Just right where you are in your seat. Just raise your hand. Heavenly Father, God, you see your people. The source of our refreshment is Jesus Christ. Fill the hearts and the spirits of the people in this room, God, with the truth of who you are. You bring refreshing to us, God. And I'm asking you to do that again. This week, God, it is a joy to be able to know you and to see the work that you're doing, God. Refresh our hearts. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.